Welcome back in to another episode of the Integrative Health Simplified podcast. We are in a series all about underlying infections, and we kicked it off with an episode on biofilm and what that is and basically how these underlying infections can hide in biofilms. And it's very important to make sure that we are addressing that before we try to go after any of these other things that we're going to talk about in the next few episodes. So hopefully you listened to that episode. If not, I would pause this and go back and listen to that, because I did share just some things to keep in mind as you're listening to these episodes. These episodes are not in any way to evoke fear or just overwhelm in this area. I really wanted to present the information in a simplified way and give you some maybe new ideas to think about and things to do to hopefully address underlying infections if you have any. So in today's episode, we're going to be talking about parasites. And just to hear that word, are you like, oh, you just cringe? I totally get it. I talk about parasites a lot because they are something that definitely go unnoticed a lot of times, that are causing some of the issues that just seem random, but they're definitely not. So I'm actually going to give you a pretty exhaustive list of all the symptoms that can come from parasites and just give you some ideas on like how you can possibly determine if you have those. And obviously we'll talk about what you might could do. So big picture here. Much of what we know and understand about this super stealth pathogen is few and far between, because we don't have really great tests to detect them. That's something that's really a little bit different about parasites, is that there isn't a great test to detect them. So sometimes people really want to know definitively, do I have parasites? And there really is not a good test to point them to. And so I'm going to share, you kind of have to go off symptoms, because they do cause a variety of vague symptoms, and they're a lot more common than we realize. I think sometimes we just kind of dismiss them like, okay, I haven't been to a third world country. Like, I don't, you know, I'm not seeing parasites in my stool. Like, you know, are you sure that I have these, Kari? So I'm not sure. You know, we're going to talk about the ways that you might could be a detective of your own health. So, but just continuing with the big picture, studies really indicate that parasites and viruses have a symbiotic relationship that we don't really fully understand. And so many parasites act as a holding tank for heavy metals as well. So that's something that we're going to talk about, in the fact that they actually are there for a reason. So parasites are not actually the root cause. If you want to address parasites, you actually really want to think about why they're there in the first place and how you can obviously help your body to release some that it's holding on to if you have an overabundance of parasites, and also simultaneously address why they're there in the first place. So this is why we start detoxing parasites first after drainage is prepped and ready. So that's kind of like the big picture as we start this episode off, but just understanding these creatures a little bit more. So parasites are incredibly diverse. There are three main types of parasites: protozoa, helminthes, or like the worms that you can actually see. Protozoa you usually can't see with the naked eye, but helminthes or worms you can typically see. And then there's ectoparasites, which is something like a tick. So those are the three main categories. And, you know, parasites have been around for millions and millions of years. And a lot of those years, the majority of those years, they really were around and we coexisted with them, and they didn't cause much harm. So that kind of brings up the question, like, why are they causing issues now? What's different? And I am definitely convinced that it's our lifestyle. It's much different, obviously, than our ancestors. We are simply overloaded with more stress than they could ever imagine having. More chemicals, more processed foods. Like, it just creates a really great environment for more parasites to stick around, because again, going back to the fact that they act as a holding tank for a lot of the things that our body deems as foreign, that it wants to like hide away, like heavy metals and chemicals and toxins and things like that. And so parasites do stick around more because they are actually helping us out in that way. But it's really the fact of when they just get so in overabundance that they really start causing problems. So some parasites, you know, have a symbiotic relationship with their host. If they're not overgrown, if they're not in excess, they can really provide us some good benefits. But it's when they have just proliferated over and over again that we start to see major issues. So what is a parasite? According to the CDC, a parasite is an organism that lives on or in a host organism and gets its food from or at the expense of its hosts. So parasites, like I said, have continued to evolve for billions of years into a collection of diverse and various forms that are crucial in the circle of life. However, in today's age, parasites do play a part in the root cause of disease that is often overlooked. And so that's just something to consider, that, you know, I don't want to like demonize parasites, because again, they're there for a reason and we've coexisted with them for millions of years, but it's really the fact that they are just overpopulated, and that's what is associated with the issues that we see physically. And so I do want to touch on like, where do they come from? So parasites come from a couple of different places. They can come from contaminated water. They can definitely come from animals. You can pretty much guarantee if you have a cat or dog, especially that lives in the house or that you're around a lot, that maybe licks you, things like that, you're going to get more parasites from that. They can come from human to human contact, factory farm meats or undercooked raw meat. So you'll often hear like sushi, you know, is a big one. Fresh foods, obviously sushi has, if it has raw meat or if it has raw vegetables, it can definitely come from that. Travel, obviously, if you're going outside of the country and they have a different, there's just a lot of differences in water and food and all of that. You're just very much at risk for contracting parasites in different countries because of that reason. Simply walking barefoot outside, which we know is really great for us. It's called grounding. Grounding is amazing for us. Being outside, walking barefoot, all those things are great, but you know, you are going to be just more exposed to parasites, you know, digging in the dirt, things like that. And again, these things aren't bad. We're going to live our life. We're going to come in contact with them. It's really the fact of we're a really good host to keep them around. That's what you don't want to be. You don't want to be a good host for parasites, because again, I don't want to create fear of like, oh my gosh, I don't need to walk outside, or I don't need to travel to another country, or whatever it might be. You know, we're going to live our life. I don't want to, you know, evoke fear, but again, just trying to help you understand how you can become less of a great host for these is my goal with this podcast. So I want to go through sort of an extensive list of symptoms, and I'm not doing that just so I can rattle off all of these. I'm really doing it so that you can see parasites do cause a ton of different issues. And so when I go through all of the list, I'm going to kind of give you some ideas of like how you can see if you might, you know, some of these things might be connected for you. So hold tight for that, but I'm going to go through this list. So we have abdominal pain, anemia, anger, anxiety, autoimmune issues, bloating, blood sugar, body temperature issues, brain fog is a really big one with parasites, breathing problems, constipation is also a big one with parasites, because parasites, especially worms, secrete something that causes you to be constipated, because again, they're trying to survive in the body. And so they're going to do anything they can to survive longer. So a lot of times they'll secrete things that actually make you constipated. Cravings is a big one, because they do steal nutrients. So it makes sense why your body would be craving certain things, because it's missing those nutrients. Depression, diarrhea, difficulty gaining or losing weight, eye problems, fatigue, just feeling tired in general, gas or bloating. GERD is a big one with parasites. Insomnia is another big one. Irritability, joint pain, leaky gut, which is basically what causes autoimmune issues, and just that your gut lining is not intact. Learning disabilities, liver pain, loss of appetite, migraines or headaches. That's a really big one too. Mood disorders. Can you see how many of these things are kind of related to temperament or mood? that's a big one because the parasites steal neurotransmitters and kind of interrupt how they're made, which is in the gut. That kind of makes sense if you think about it that way. Nausea or vomiting, neurological problems, nightmares, numbness, actually seeing a worm in your stool, of course, persistent cough, pins and needles sensations, PMS, POTS is a big one. Rash or itching around the rectum, shortness of breath, sinus problems, skin issues, sleep problems, stomach pain or tenderness, tingling, unusual heart rhythm, upset stomach, urinary tract infection, vaginal infection, vertigo, viruses, and weight loss. So I know that was like a long list, but I want you to think about maybe you pause it, go back and listen after I give you some questions to kind of think through. So first off, do you have 12 or more of these symptoms? That would be a really good sign that you might have some parasites that need to be dealt with. Have you ruled out other issues that might be causing these symptoms? And lastly, do you have symptoms that I listed that get worse around a full moon? So you might have heard me talk about, if you've been following me, or you might have just heard it from other people, about maybe doing a parasite cleanse around a full moon or something like that. So the reason why people, you know, talk about the full moon in relation to parasites is because, you know, it's okay. So first off, if you hear that and you're like, that sounds crazy, I totally get it. I am very diligent about, I do not want to fall into any traps with like new age things. And like, I'm always just really diligent and kind of hyper aware of that. So I did my research and there's actually a physical shift in your melatonin and serotonin around a full moon. And this is what causes parasites to be more active around a full moon. So, you know, you just think about the tide and how full moon affects that. Like a full moon definitely affects a lot more things than we might even realize. Like it's really cool even to think about how much they did things around a moon, the moon cycle and all back in like biblical times. I think that's super interesting. And so I know that we've kind of gotten away from that, but a lot of people still do things around the full moon and, you know, believe certain things around the full moon. So this is actually scientifically proven though. So, do the symptoms get worse around a full moon? That's a really, really classic sign that it truly is parasites that you're dealing with. So that hopefully just helps you to kind of, you know, see if this might be an issue for you, because like I said, testing just is not accurate. And so we really have to go off of signs and symptoms primarily, but you can look at a few blood markers that do kind of coincide with signs and symptoms, but truly you can just go off that to do a parasite cleanse. And honestly, most people have parasites that need to be, you know, dealt with, even if it's just one time a year. Like most other people in different cultures do a parasite cleanse at least one time a year, just as a ritual. And so that's just something to consider. Like, why don't we? It just makes sense to do that just to keep things at bay. Even if you're not a great host, you still might have some things that sort of build up and, you know, our lifestyle changes. So sometimes we're more stressed than others, or sometimes we're just not taking care of ourselves as well as we should. So that's just something to consider. But just to touch on testing really quickly. So I mentioned that there's no accurate test for parasites. There's a couple of different reasons for that. So parasites actually have a self-dissolving mechanism. They can excrete an enzyme that makes them dissolve in about 24 hours after being purged from the body. And so if you're doing something like a stool test, they're not going to show up in that for that reason possibly. And then also examining a stool sample, sometimes you miss, you know, different phases of parasites. So like eggs, obviously, or a more mature. And some of these aren't even detectable. You know, they're just so microscopic. And so sometimes they're just missed in a sample. And so that's another reason why there's really no great accurate test. And then lastly, it's because parasites don't only live in the colon. They can live all throughout the body. They love living in the brain and sinuses and lungs, pancreas, joints, and many organs. The liver is a big one that is often clogged with parasites. If you're having a lot of problems that relate back to your liver. So that is just some reasons why mainly you would go off signs and symptoms. So as we kind of round out, again, I just want to reiterate, it is very important to not have fear around this, but to realize that there are reasons why you might be a really good host for parasites to stick around. And if you have a lot of those symptoms, then I would definitely consider working with someone that is trained in this area. My team and I are trained to help people work through different issues of for underlying infections. And really, you know, the topics that I'll talk about after this episode, you have to start with parasites first, because parasites hold on to so many other things and they hold their weight in all of that. And so it just kind of makes sense that you have to make sure you address parasites before you even think about addressing things like mold or Lyme or, you know, other things like that. So that is something that you definitely want to consider doing. But, you know, there are people that want to kind of DIY it. And I actually made a free guide for this and that I will share in the show notes and the description of this video. And you can kind of check that out. It helps you to make sure you have drainage pathways that are open, because as I mentioned in the last episode, when I talk about biofilm, that you have to make sure that when you're killing these things off, that it is going to actually exit your body, because the last thing you want to do is try to kill all these things off and then they just recirculate. And that causes a lot of, you know, I mean, it can be really a serious issue. So I know that, you know, some people really just want to do it on their own, and I think it can be done. I've put some things in the guide that are really going to help you to have the best success possible whenever you do this on your own. But really, you should be working with a practitioner that's trained in this, that can make sure, you know, that how long you need to do a parasite cleanse and the different products that might be the best for you. So they just have a different vantage point, because we're looking at blood work and signs and symptoms and trying to put all of these things together in the best plan for you. And sometimes it's really hard to do that for yourself, because you're just too close to the situation and you might not have all the pieces to the puzzle. So I'm going to put our information for myself and the others on my team in the show notes and in the description. So you can kind of check that out if this is something that you feel like you want to invest in. And so thank you for joining me on this episode. I know that parasites can be like a, I don't know, just kind of an odd topic to talk about, but I really think that it should be normalized, because again, we've been coexisting with parasites for millions of years. And so it just makes sense with the modern day and time that we live in, that we need to really address these and keep them at a safe level in our body. It's not about eradicating every single parasite, because that's really not possible. And they're part of our normal ecosystem of our body. But whenever they just get in abundance, that's really when you see the issue. So just managing that and trying to become a not so great host so these things don't stick around. That's kind of our goal. And so, again, I'm excited that you're here for this series. I'm going to be talking about more underlying infections in the next coming episode. So stay tuned for those, and I'll see you on the next one.